Welcome to Love Fellowship Believers. Hey, we're at our new location, 1900 Martin Luther King Jr. Avenue. We would love to have you. We're located at Gillespie Park Elementary School. We're doing a new thing. God has a vision for us to increase, step up, and step out in ministry. We look forward to seeing you there. Amen, amen, amen. First, I want to say good morning to everyone. Amen. Good morning to everyone for being here. I tried to get everybody's hand. If I miss you, I'm sorry. Amen. I want to say thank you to my fellow classmates. 25 years ago, we graduated. Amen. And they showed up here today. Amen, amen. I know I don't look that old, right? I don't look that old. I don't look that old. Amen, amen. Habakkuk chapter 2. We read it early in your hearing. Once you find it, if you're able, would you stand to your feet to honor God's word? Habakkuk chapter 2. If you have a church Bible, I believe it was on page 799. Habakkuk chapter 2. Very small book, only a few chapters. Right there close to the end of the Old Testament. Habakkuk chapter 2, one of the most familiar verses in this chapter is in chapter 2. It talks about writing the vision and making it plain. And we're going to look at the next few verses after that. Next couple of verses after that, verse number 3 and verse number 4. Habit, would you say amen?
Amen.
You need some more time, say wait a minute.
Amen.
All right, we're going to hold on then. Page 799 if you have a church Bible. If you're pulling it up on an app, Habakkuk, H-A-B-A-K-K-U-K. Habakkuk, chapter 2, starting at the third verse. It says, "For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. Behold, his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him, but the just shall live by his faith." Let us pray. Father God, first and foremost, we say thank you. God, thank you for this time, God, and thank you for this moment. God, thank you for this opportunity even to bring your word here today. Lord, I ask that you would open up ears, hearts, and minds, that we would be receptive to your word. Lord, we need you. We can't make it without you. God, we need a word from you, Father, that will help us to make it through what the enemy has laid before us. God, bless us here today, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And amen, 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 amen. You have a church program. If you have a church program and you're writing down some notes, if you need a church program, we'll make sure you get one. But if you're writing down some notes for today's sermon, the title is, "Don't Leave Your Faith Here." Don't leave your faith here. I don't know how much study you've done with Habakkuk. It's a very unique book. I haven't found, personally myself, any other book that speaks like Habakkuk speaks. There are some similarities, but I haven't found another book that actually speaks like Habakkuk speaks. If you was to actually take the book of Habakkuk and look at it in its entirety, you'll see that it's basically a conversation. Habakkuk was a different kind of prophet. He wasn't the same type of prophet as you mostly see in the Old Testament. He wasn't one that was there to proclaim judgment was coming against the nation because they had messed up because of all this kind of stuff. But Habakkuk was one that actually saw just a lot going on. The Bible doesn't tell a lot about Habakkuk's background. It doesn't tell about a lot where he's from. Theologians go back and forth over the fact of what does his name really mean and all of that. But what's important is that Habakkuk was there during a very pivotal transition for God's chosen people. They were coming out of the Assyrian bondage, and they were starting to go into the Babylonian bondage. And as in the process of going from one slave master, if you wanted to the next slave master, from one overseer to the next overseer, God's children were being persecuted. And Habakkuk sat back and he had the question, why? Why must it be like this? Why must we go through this? Why should it happen this way? And I think it's something that everyone can identify with. Because I believe we've all had a question when we've asked God, why? Why did my mother have to go before her time? Why did my father have to go before his time? Why did my children have to go? Why did my friend have to leave? Why is it that I'm working so hard, but it seems like everybody else is getting a promotion? But why? Is there anyone that can't identify with why? So Habakkuk, he's asking why. And if you, again, look at these three chapters and you read this in its entirety, you'll see in this first chapter, that's what he's starting to do. He's saying why? Why? Why must we go through what we're going through? Habakkuk chapter 1, first few verses. Verse number 3, why dost thou show me iniquity and cause me to uphold grievance? For spoiling good and violence are before me, and they are to raise up strife in contention. He goes on here in these first few verses, and he's asking questions, and God has given him answers. And we get here as in this dialogue here to chapter 2, and God starts to respond. Verse 3, he first tells him to write the vision, but verse 3 he says, for the vision is yet for an appointed time. There's things that we're going to go through. There's things that that's going to happen in our lives. And there's promises that God has for us. But a lot of times where we mess up is that we try to get ahead of something before it's time. He says, but it's but for an appointed time. But at the end, but when the time comes, when time is over, when time is up, it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, though it's going to take a while, wait for it. Because it will surely come. Yeah. It's going to show up right when you need it. Yeah. We're living in a day that it's real easy to come here on Sunday morning, on Wednesday night, on Thursday night, on Tuesday night, or whatever night for Bible study. It sounds real good when we type it in on Facebook. And we tell each other, yes, well, I love the Lord, and God's doing so good for me, and this. But it's another thing to actually live it. Don't leave your faith here. Don't come to church here and praise the Lord and throw your hands up and talk about how good God is and how you're going to have faith in your situation, but then walk out this afternoon and begin to doubt the Lord. And then begin to even say he can't do it. He can't fix it. He's not strong enough. I've gone through this. I've gone through that. Because of my circumstance, because of my situation, I'll never make it. Don't leave your faith here. If you continue on in chapter 2 and you go to verse number 3, and the part B of verse number 4, it says, but the just shall live by his faith. But the just shall live by his faith. This is God responding to Habakkuk, and he's telling Habakkuk, he says, you know what? I know it looks bad. I know my people are going through. I know the oppressor is doing the oppressing. I know that folk are getting killed. I know that folk children are ended up missing. I know that we're living in a time that the economy is bad. I know that everything else seems to be going on. I know that foreclosures are happening. Jobs are not going. Folk are dealing with unemployment. Folk don't have food. People are sleeping outside. There's more homeless now than there's ever been before. There's more folk in prison than there's ever been before. I know what's going on. But keep my faith. Keep the faith. because it ain't going to always be like this. It's not going to always be this way. I don't know how your situation, I don't know what you're going through. But I'm sure that if we was just to take a survey, everyone in here would have something to say about a situation, about a circumstance in their life. Don't leave your faith here. Don't leave your faith here. Don't just have faith in the sanctuary. But when you're driving in your car, still keep faith. When you're on your job and your bosses, still keep faith. When you go home and your spouse and your church, still keep faith. No matter what the situation is, continue to keep faith through it all. For the Bible says, the just shall live by faith. We have a men's meeting. Brother James McClary has started more Men of Resolution Everywhere, and a couple of young men there that are going through and having some problems, and there's a little phrase that I keep mentioning to these young men. There's a little phrase: you get right when you do right. You get right when you do right. I know there's been many a times I've told my own testimony of different things that I've gone through and all of that other kind of stuff. Well, I have some witnesses here today. I have some witnesses here today that can tell you their preaching probably was on the last thing that anybody thought Kevin Webb would ever be doing. But God has things set up for us. And if we do right, we'll be right. If we do what it is he's telling us to do, it'll line up. He says here in Scripture, wait. Don't try to do it before it's time. Don't try to step out and do something that I hadn't told you to do yet. Not that you don't have the ability, but you're only going to have the authority at a certain time. You might have the ability to do what it is that I'm calling you to do because I've placed it in you. But if you do it out of order, you're going to be wrong. If you look here in this same book, chapter number one, we saw some questions being asked. Chapter number two, we're seeing some questions being answered. But if you start to look over in chapter number three has some praising going on. Chapter number three, Habakkuk's realizing, you know what, I might can't see it just yet, but I know that it's on the way. He says, you know what, I can't see it working out in my favor, but God, because you said so, I'm going to have faith that it's going to work out. And Habakkuk starts to praise God. And the Bible tells me that God inhabits the praises of his people. So I'm here to tell you today, don't leave your faith here. Whatever your situation is, whatever it is that you're going through, it's okay to ask God why. It's okay to have a conversation with him. I'm here to tell you, he will give you the answer. And sometimes you'll hear exactly what you're looking for. But most of the time, you're going to be told to wait. Most of the time, you're going to be told, not just yet. It's right around the corner. But whatever the answer is, declare in your heart that I'm still going to praise him. Declare in your heart that I'm still going to be happy about it because I know in the end, God's going to work it out for me. I know in the end, it's going to be what he created it to be for me. Yeah, my enemy might look as though they're prospering, but you know what? That's not going to last. I know that God has something in store for me. It might not look like I'm going to make it, but I know God has my back. I spoke to a young man yesterday. We had church under the bridge. And as soon as I walked up, I don't even remember the guy's name with the beard. Yeah. Y'all remember his name? I remember his name, but as soon as I walked up, our spirits connected and we started talking and he went to explain his life to me, all the different things he had gone through and the drug addictions and all that other kind of stuff, but now was explaining just how much on fire for the Lord that he was.
And he said, that's my wife over there in the blue shirt. That's my wife over there in the blue shirt. And we've been together 30 years. He said, but the first 11 years of that, I wasn't any good. The first 11 years of that, I didn't do anything that I was supposed to do. He said, but I remember my wife telling me that she was going to continue to pray for me because this wasn't going to last always. And for the last half, more than the last half of these 30 years, God has blessed us. And it's such a wonderful thing. And what if she had given up on me? Our conversation went on and I said, wow, I said, it's amazing. I said, because I sit back and I listen how many times somebody told me about Jesus. How many times somebody told me about God. How even that we're in our midst and we're in our mess, he's still blessing us. He's still protecting us. Because the Bible says that all of our righteousness is as filthy rags. It says that the wages of sin is death. And every single one of us have sinned. So none of us have the right to be where we are right now. God in his infinite wisdom and his all power could instantly say, I'm calling them all home. And there's nothing anyone could complain about. Because we all have areas where we've fallen short. And I said, God, it allowed me to hear about this Jesus so many thousands and thousands and thousands of times. But it was just one time that I heard it that it sounded different to me. It was one time that somebody said it that it really touched my heart where it had never done that before. Don't leave your faith here. There's somebody that needs to hear your testimony. There's somebody that needs to hear what God's done for you. There's somebody that needs to know that in spite of your situation, you held on and God showed up. Don't leave your faith here. Amen? Amen. Amen. Come on, let's put our hands together for the Lord.
Thank you for fellowshipping with us here at Love Fellowship Believers. I hope something was said, something was done that really touched your heart and God is starting to work and change your life for the better. We would love to have you to continue to come out and fellowship with us. We're at 1900 Martin Luther King Jr. Avenue in the beautiful city of Greensboro, North Carolina. We're located actually in Gillespie Park Elementary School. We look forward to having you to come out and fellowship with us. Remember, God loves you and so do I.